Ever read a book that promised to get straight to the point and make a difficult topic simple? In 1729, Isaac Greenwood wrote one about math. His how-to guide wasn't a new idea, and in a market full of imported British math books, Greenwood's book didn't sell well. So why is it here in the Library of Congress? My name is Ralph Pantozzi, an Albert Einstein Distinguished Educator Fellow at the Library. Let's find out. Greenwood's Arithmetic is the first math textbook published here in what became the United States and written by a person born in the American colonies. Greenwood, a shipbuilder's son, born in Boston in 1702, presented math as a tool for the masses, still a radical idea at the time. Greenwood was a minister who broke traditions. He reinterpreted religious principles, promoted smallpox vaccination, and advocated hands-on learning. He brought invention, entrepreneurship, and persistence to his writing and teaching. He also fought and lost a battle with alcohol addiction. One way to know the world and the people in it is through books. In the United States, we like to demonstrate our ingenuity, work ethic, and independence. We also know much about struggles. Greenwood's legacy is a very human one, and this book is a window into it. The book's style, format, and content are also a mirror on the present. Let's take a look. In the title, the word arithmetic meant any kind of calculation, even those we might learn in high school today. Vulgar meant fractions, like two-thirds, in contrast with decimals, like 0.5. Application to trade and commerce referred to topics needed in daily life, such as calculations with pounds, shillings, and pence, which befuddled the colonists as much as it might puzzle us today. Greenwood was concise in his writing. He spoke directly to the reader, telling them they needed only a few examples to understand the math. He designed each chapter so that it could be read independently of the others. He added the innovation of blank space so that readers could create examples wrought by themselves right next to his explanations. The owners of this book took him up on the offer. Reports of Greenwood's classroom teaching indicated he performed experiments where students could observe scientific principles firsthand. In math, he likely didn't bring horses to class, but he did use what we sometimes call word problems to connect to the reader's daily life. As a bonus for the discerning reader, Greenwood included the newest shortcuts to calculation, discovered by Isaac Newton, which Greenwood learned on a trip to England in the early 1720s. Shortcuts were valued by the busy colonist of the 18th century. However, Greenwood, inspired by his religious beliefs, also valued pausing to be curious about the wonders of the world. I invite you to pause and examine this long cut, which shows why we carry the one when we add. A number of Greenwood students became well-known mathematicians. Greenwood's colleagues noted his effective teaching methods. But even on the trip to England, they worried about his sobriety. In 1738, Greenwood was fired from his professorship due to excessive drinking. Benjamin Franklin knew of his work and welcomed him in Philadelphia, advertising and hosting Greenwood's public lectures and scientific demonstrations. Despite this assistance, Greenwood died a few years later, overcome by his addiction. The "you can do it" attitude, evident in the language of this book, may reflect Isaac Greenwood's own struggles. While the book was almost forgotten to history, Greenwood's interest in practical experimentation is part of the spirit of the American Revolution. We became a nation of strivers, makers, doers, and thinkers. The roots of the industry, technology, and creativity around us today are right here in this little math book. Thanks for joining us for this exploration of the earliest American math textbook.